Hi, everyone. We're having a ModPo meetup at the Harold Washington Library in downtown Chicago. I'm joined today by Tim, Mark, Richard, Dexter, Jordan, and Matt. We are going to read Wallace Stevens' The Anecdote of the Jar. Let's get to it. Anecdote of the Jar by Wallace Stevens. I placed the jar in Tennessee, and round it was, upon a hill. It made the slovenly wilderness surround that hill. The wilderness rose up to it and sprawled around, no longer wild. The jar was round upon the ground and tall and of a port in air. It took dominion everywhere. The jar was gray and bare. It did not give of bird or bush like nothing else in Tennessee. So, jar. Why a jar?
Man-made.
Yeah.
That's something that.
There's also the idea of jar being something that catches you, you know, like.
Something jarring.
Yeah, well, it holds things.
So it placed a jar in Tennessee.
It's something that holds something else.
Well, Tim, you said that there's something in it.
It could be.
Could be. Okay, great. So, something maybe in it. And Tennessee's a vast place, right? Like, I placed the jar in Tennessee. Like, Jesus, probably already jars in Tennessee, right? Why? You know, it's the scale is jarring, I guess, right? To think you place a jar. Why not say I placed a jar in on one of the Smoky Mountains, or I placed a jar in Memphis. I placed the jar in Tennessee, it's like saying I placed the jar in Illinois. And round it was upon a hill. So round, we already said the jar might be round, the hill might be round. There's an echo with surround a little bit later. It made the slovenly wilderness surround. Slovenly wilderness. What's that?
Well, just the wilderness, even without the jar, would have been slovenly. It's not tamed.
Right? I don't think that's the meaning exactly. I think that it's a sense of chaos. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think of it as a mason jar. You know, it hadn't had anything in it, it would have been moonshine. Right. The opposing ideas of something that's so simple and produces nothing, and the wilderness that has no Corey Stevens in his poem anyway, no defining. But there's also the idea of suddenly, as in somebody who doesn't take care of themselves, they think of them as suddenly. So this is kind of an untouched wilderness in a way, one that has not
slowly has
matured in a sense.
So you're saying, Dexter, that it's so it's pejorative, but you're also saying that it means not manicured or maintained.
Yeah, not maintained, not touched.
There's something extra
untouched in a way, but also. Slovenly is not kind of pleasant.
So at least in this first stanza, do we get the sense that Stevens is being down on nature and wilderness by using that pejorative slovenly?
I think the problem for me is how does placing the jar on the hill make the wilderness more slovenly?
That's the problem for anybody reading this book.
Around the hill. Why is, you know, is this jar somehow attracting the jungles to come, or the, you know, the wilderness to come up to the hill?
It's dominating the wilderness. It's almost funny that you take this tiny little, like, predictable, like, mass-produced, like, object. the jar is the one that's making that happen.
Right, right.
It was the imagination of the artist that's making that happen.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
It's just the position of a man-made artifact on a hill. You've suddenly got a focus, you've got this and that.
Exactly.
So it was always Slavonin without the jar, if I recall myself.
But that's what I keep going to the next stanza. Jordan, you already started to talk about the way that the jar commands the wilderness, right? So we have the wilderness rose up to it, presumably the jar, and sprawled around, no longer wild. So what's the change here with the slovenly wilderness? And how
it's been tamed.
It's been tamed. So wilderness no longer wild. What?
It has a direction. It's going towards the jar.
Is it also no longer slovenly?
The fact of this man-made object being introduced into nature creates the contrast whereby we suddenly see nature as wild or slovenly, right? And it also seems in this case to be by that same contrast, calling into being or something the ground and the air, right? That it's gradually just the fact of placing it on the hill and stepping back, it's gradually making all of these things appear around it. The wilderness, you suddenly notice that there's ground, right? Like ground becomes ground when something is on it. Right. The air becomes air when something is in it, right? And especially if it's tall and in it.
So would like the open mouth of the jar be a port in the air? Is that
if it's open, yeah. It's right, we don't know.
Are you talking about calling it to be like from Heideggerian kind of?
I think it's a real jar.
I mean, I'm not confident enough in what I know about Heidegger to say that. I don't mean capital B being more just going along the way you're saying, Richard, about the fact that it's a prism, that there's, you know, the idea of order and imagination, right? That the imagination helps to organize things, right? And the jar is perhaps the imaginary prism that helps you see the nature or see the wilderness.
And I think that it's also trying to say that it's like overpowering, right? Because the sun is just dominion everywhere. So it's on the ground, it's tall, it's in the air, it's absolutely all over the place. But then it's gray and bare. So I think there's still some contradiction happening here in terms of where the jar is and how, I guess, Stevens feels about the jar being there.
That's true. We don't know how he feels about it. Dominion, since you just pointed us to that, Jordan, what do we make of dominion? It took dominion everywhere. The jar took dominion everywhere.
Ruler.
It ruled. What does it rule? Is it the dominion over nature?
That still untamed, sprawling wilderness. That's right. Yeah. No, sprawl was not taming. I mean, that'd be quite slovenly. But my mama, when I sprawl, would always tell me I was not tamed.
And that too, saying, like, as the wilderness is sprawling, it's no longer wild. What does that mean? If it's sprawling, but called not wild anymore.
Mm-hmm. Look at all the rounds in this poem.
Yep.
This is to hear as much as to mean. That's part of where the vein comes.
Yeah. Round it was upon a hill, surround the hill. The jar was round upon the ground.
Sprawled around.
Sprawled around, yes.
Right.
So there's the idea that the jar is circular, but also the wilderness is circular sort of around it. So it's both of them are acting in a way that's around.
Yeah. So what if the jar is on top of the hill? Because if it were, then it would be round, right? I mean, the apex of the hill would be...
It's upon a hill.
Right.
And upon the ground.
The emphasis on roundness too makes me think that what's unique or interesting about a jar in the wilderness is that a jar, because it's a mass-produced object, is very likely perfectly round in a way that nothing in the wilderness is, right? So,
right.
So I think there's this emphasis on the roundness, so like the sonic emphasis, the banging along, as you said, Richard, like, it really means to call attention to the fact that suddenly roundness exists in this world in a way that it didn't before, right? That something surrounds the jar because we have this crystal clear image of perfect roundness. Is there a meta-poetic reading? That's a trick question in ModPo’ers. There's always a meta-poetic reading. What is the meta-poetic reading of this poem? We got some ideas out about imagination and how it works sort of alongside nature, and then also about man-made objects. So does this all tie together somehow in a reading about poetry in general? Is there a thesis here that Stevens is elaborating about what poetry does, can do, or should be? I think an obvious way in would be to read the jar as a poem.
Right.
But I'm not sure that entirely tells the whole story.
I would like to say that Stevens was always looking for a way to perceive nature, and felt that the senses were apt to make you misperceive it, that you didn't really know it, and that it was only through art and the imagination that you get an individual perception of what Tennessee really comprises.
Right.
And that's kind of the function of art.
There's an old saying that the sheriff has heard, in the land of the blind, one man is king.
Mm-hmm.
Well, in this land, this jar is king. Because it's more round than everything
else. It has a certain...
And maybe what we're being told here, it doesn't give a food or a bird bush. It's kind of worthless other than being round in an unround world. So maybe it's a comment on things that we give importance to that really maybe aren't so important.
Giving importance to everyday man-made objects?
Man-made objects or societal values sometimes really, in the long run, are very important. This is not about society, it's about their own.
In a way, it sort of is about society.
I think it is.
The dominion of the jar. These things that we make, these everyday objects, seem to extend humanity's dominion over everything.
Right. The reason it has dominion is because of its value given to it in comparison to other things. It's jar, so it's very bare. It's just round.
And then very much there is a speaker, right? I was a jar, not there was a jar,
right,
in Tennessee. So so there is someone witnessing this very presently. And what I mean, I might be being a little bit literal, but it says it did not give a bird bush like nothing else in Tennessee. Well, dude, you stood there and you put the jar there and you don't give a bird bush, then you must be in Tennessee.
Right.
So there's like it makes me question kind of more what the jar is doing